Great. Now it's recording. Okay. Okay, so we look at this guy. The absolute values of the successive differences. And first of all, we want to claim this is integrable. And how do we do that? Well, the point is that this is exactly, we can just think of G here defined pointwise by that formula, okay? But then the L1 norm of G is bounded by the sum of the L1 norms of all the pieces, and those L1 norms are certainly okay. So it's integrable. Is converging pointwise to a finite value almost everywhere. The alternative here is that it's converging to infinity on some set of positive measure, but then it couldn't be integrable. Okay, so integrability is giving us that almost everywhere it's converging to something finite. And thus, if we instead look at f, if we drop the absolute value signs. Oops, drop them. This is also converging almost everywhere. Well, since it converges absolutely almost everywhere. So this is this amazing fact back from first year. Absolute convergence implies convergence, without which would be trouble. Okay, so all that we do is just let f be that pointwise limit. Almost everywhere. But the point is, of course, that since each of the fn's are actually dominated by this g that we wrote down, which was integrable, so why is it, why is this? Well, you can think of, you can write fn as just take finitely many terms here, so it all telescopes and you just get fn at the end, if you only take finitely many terms. And so you can see that fn is take some subset of the terms, that subset of the terms is smaller than the corresponding subset here, plus some extra positive bit. So we get that by the dominated convergence theorem. In fact, we have fn goes to f in the L1 sense. Okay. And that did it. So it's a little bit tricky that we have to go build this dominating function to make things work. Okay. So let's maybe just try and do the p between 1 and infinity case quickly, because it's not that different. Let's actually just do it in place. Sorry. There's not that much changes. We build G in exactly the same way. Of course, changing the 1 to a p would be very helpful otherwise. And then using that estimate of the triangle inequality again, we see that if you look at the p norm of G, that's bounded by the p norm of f1 plus the sum of the p norms of these guys. Which is finite by the fact that we're summing 2 to the minus n's. So that again gives you G this time isn't integrable, but what we do get is still that we But this concludes the fact that the p norm is finite is still enough to get the fact that it converges pointwise to something finite almost everywhere. At every point, this is either converging to a finite value or an infinite value. If on a positive measure set it converges to infinity, you couldn't possibly have this finite. So that does that. And then what happens? Well, we still just do exactly the same things here and here and here and get some pointwise limit. And we need to change the estimates slightly at the end. So at the end, so we can get up to that point there, and then from there we just say that we need to actually show that this f is actually an LP now. But the point here is just that this tells you that the fn to the p's are all bounded by g to the p. And that tells you that fn really is an LP. That's not so bad. And then if we just look at fnx minus f of x all to the power p, well, everything inside here is bounded by g, so we can just bound that by 2 times p times g of x to the p, and then the dominated convergence theorem applied to that difference there just gives that fn converges to 1. Okay. Sorry if that was too fast doing it in circuit replace mode rather than actually writing it out, but it's written out separately in the notes. So you can check that if you want. Okay, so now we better do the p equals infinity case, and this one's rather different. So again, we have some sequence fn, quotient L infinity. So what does that mean? Well, so for each k, where here I'm thinking of k as giving me an epsilon, I'm going to have epsilon being 2 to the minus k here, we have n sub k, so n and m, at least n sub k, says that fn of x minus fm of x is less than 2 to the minus k. Well, that's what being quotient L infinity would mean if it weren't for the awful fact that functions in L infinity are only really defined almost everywhere. So we only get to say almost everywhere. And so what we do here is we let C, K, N, M be the exceptional set. So for each k, and for each n and m bigger than that nk, the set of x's, so that this inequality fails. Okay. So certainly then the measure of c, k, n, m is zero, because, well, it held almost everywhere. And then we just let c, just be the union of all the exceptional sets, all the places where something could possibly go wrong. And of course, because it's a countable union of null sets, it's still a null set. And this is sort of what makes everything work. But even when we look at all the exceptions at once, things are just fine. Okay, so we just work on the C complement. And there the sequence fn of x is honestly Cauchy, because nothing ever goes wrong, and so we always just get that. That's just a Cauchy sequence in the real, so we let f of x be the limit. And then if you want to, but it doesn't really matter, you could just say define f arbitrarily on C itself, but maybe you don't even need to bother saying that. And now we just working on C, let's maybe write it out again. We have that inequality in the middle line, and on C that really holds everywhere, so we can just let M go to infinity after having fixed X. So on the C complement, we have as long as N and M are greater than N sub K. And so then we just get that Fn x minus f of x is less than or equal to minus k for n above there. And that's exactly saying that two things we want to say, that the infinity norm of Fn is at most the infinity norm of some Fn plus a tiny little bit, and we can do this for any k and any n then big enough. So in particular, that's finite, so the f we produced really is an L infinity function, and similarly this estimate tells you that that fn is just converging in infinity norm, in supernorm to f. Okay, so that was all fine, great. Now we have a sort of annoying feature. The thing that I wanted to go and do now is prove the second fact I wrote at the beginning, that the dual of LP is LQ. But there's another thing that we skipped over earlier in the course, which we unfortunately need now, which is this thing called the Radon-Nikodym theorem, which basically tells you how to compare two measures on the same space in a very interesting and useful way. And I'm still at this point a little bit indecisive whether I should just tell you the statement of the Radon-Nikodym theorem and then go and use it to prove this thing about LP and LQ, or whether we should actually prove the Radon-Nikodym theorem. We should do a bit of that. We should do some of this, sure. Maybe I'll put that to a vote in a moment after doing the bit that we really have to do. So we call, we can use signed measures as well as normal measures. Then the thing that I want to define is the absolute value of a measure. So if I give you nu some measure, let's define absolute value of nu, a positive measure, so that's the old-fashioned sort, by the absolute value of nu applied to some set E is just the supremum over all ways of writing E as a countable disjoint union of EIs, so that symbol is meant to be countable, of the sums of the absolute values of the nus of the EIs. Okay? So of course, if the nu that we plugged into this formula was a positive measure to begin with, and the EIs here of course are measurable. If the nu that we plugged into this formula was positive to begin with, then these absolute values would disappear away. And in fact, this sum would always just be nu of e by countable additivity of the measure. So this is saying that if nu is positive to begin with, then this doesn't do anything. But in general, we get that. And So the lemma, which I think I don't want to prove, is that mu is a measure. We need to check countable additivity. But let's skip over that. Not bother. So the thing that maybe we should do, I guess maybe two things we should do here. So first of all, now any signed measure is a difference of two positive measures. You can write mu as mu plus absolute value of mu divided by 2 plus mu minus absolute value of mu over 2. Sorry, and let me write it as a difference. And so this guy is obviously positive. Well, I guess maybe it's not quite obviously positive. The point is just that I mean, the reasons why these sums and differences are positive is basically the same reason why it's true for real numbers that x plus the absolute value of x is positive, and similarly, absolute value of x minus x is positive. It's, you just have to plug things into the definition, it comes out pretty easily. So there's that. Maybe we don't actually need that. Okay, so the interesting thing is we can put a norm on signed measures just by the formula that the norm of mu, this is horribly confusing, now I've got double bars there, is just where you calculate the absolute value of the measure and then you measure the whole space x. Okay, and it's reasonably easy to see that this is a norm. It satisfies the triangle inequality. Again, you just have to unpack the definition, and obviously homogeneity. If I double the measure, these all double. That's fine. But the really interesting thing is that the space of signed measures actually becomes a Banach space as a result. And so this is an important example. Because it's, well, a Banach space that isn't just an LP space that we probably should look at. Okay, so how much of this do I actually want to do? I think we should make a choice here between either proving this and really stating Radon-Nikodym and not proving Radon-Nikodym, or leaving this as an assertion that you can look at in the notes if you feel like it, and proving Radon-Nikodym. The two reasons to do one versus the other is here, it's sort of, this is yet another example of kind of proving that things are Banach spaces, which is an interesting thing to do while we're learning about Banach spaces. The reason instead to do Radon-Nikodym is it's a nice sort of piece of interaction between Hilbert space theory and measure theory. It's kind of neat to see that interaction. Any votes? I would have been done with all this example stuff by the end of the week, so I want to...
I'm keen for Radon-Nikodym.
Radon-Nikodym? Everyone seems happy with Radon-Nikodym? Okay. Yeah, this proof here, it's in the notes. It's spelled out pretty carefully in the notes. But it's got lots of epsilons and deltas. Okay, so let's understand radon decay. Okay, so we need a few definitions to get there. So first we'll say mu, a measure obviously, is supported on some subset of the whole space if the measure of, we better be careful here, the measure of any for any set outside of the measure of that set is zero. I didn't just want to say that the measure of X complement was zero, because I wanted this definition to make sense for signed measures as well. So for a signed measure, the measure of X complement could add up to zero, but it might have pieces inside it that had positive and negative measures that cancel. So I better say that to be really careful. And so then two measures are mutually singular. This is a ridiculous word, I'm not quite sure why anyone bothered introducing it. If they are supported on disjoint sets, I feel like disjoint is a perfectly good word. But nevertheless, measure theorists decided they were going to do that. And then if we've got a signed measure, and mu is positive, we say that mu, the signed guy, is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. Mu of some set being zero implies that mu of that set is zero. Okay. So fine. That's all very well. Let's just give an example of mutually singular set of mutually singular measures. If I just take Lebesgue measure on the real line, and a Dirac measure at zero, it might be surprising that those count as mutually singular, because you might think Lebesgue measure surely is supported on all of R. But in fact, Lebesgue measure is supported on R take away the singleton zero, okay? If you look in the definition, any subset of the singleton zero is measure zero, so that's fine. So you can think of Lebesgue measure supported away from zero. This guy's supported at zero, so these guys count as mutually singular, even though Lebesgue measure sort of, it's not like it's not there at zero. Great, an example of absolutely continuous measures is, so given some integrable function, we can define a signed measure mu of e to just be the integral over e of that function with respect to some positive measure that we've already got around. Of course, this might be signed because f might be signed. And you should think here even just where mu is the Lebesgue case. Okay? And then mu is absolutely continuous with respect to mu. For the very simple reason that if you stick in a set E here that has mu measure zero, this integral is zero regardless of what the function was trying to do. So you get that implication there. So the point of the Radon-Nikodym theorem is actually that essentially the second case, well, essentially this example is really telling you everything. So So let's see, so what we need, we want x, m, mu, a sigma finite measure space. Did I change letters relative between the two examples? No, I didn't, mu is the positive one. Okay. And so here, perhaps implicitly when people say measure space, that means that the measure is a positive one. And here we want to have new a sigma finite sine dimension on that same measurable space. Okay, so then you can write nu as a sum of two measures, where the nu s is singular with respect to mu. So this is saying, okay, there's some piece of nu that you just can't see from the point of view of mu. It's supported off in places where mu can't tell us anything about. So we're just not going to get to say anything about that, except that it's supported away from where mu is, plus some other bit. When ua is absolutely continuous with respect to mu, and even better, and in fact, there exists f let's write say that it's I don't quite want to I was going to write that it's an L1 of x mu, but I don't quite want to do that. I want to allow a little bit worse than that. The problem is, I'd really better write an extended mu integral function. So what do I mean by that? Well, I want to allow the possibility that the integral of this guy with respect to mu is plus infinity, but I don't want to allow that it's negative infinity, okay? In fact, so there exists this f, so this absolutely continuous part is exactly of that form over here. It's just the integral over e of f. Okay? So we call f the radonicative derivative, which way around does it go? That's clearly d mu. Okay? Because if you think about what this thing is saying, it's equivalently saying that we can do the integral of some function with respect to d nu a as the integral of f. Let's leave, put it in another order, of g times f d mu. And if you think of f as being a derivative here, the formal symbols cancel in just the right way to explain that. Okay. So this is this great fact, the theorem as stated is quite general. In particular, mu and nu are both sigma finite, and nu might be signed. So let's just do the case where both nu and nu are finite, and where nu is positive. Because by now, hopefully, you guys all have a gut instinct that the other cases are going to be easy. If they're not sigma finite, you can chop your space up into pieces where they are finite and prove the theorem over and over again, all of the pieces. And in the case where nu is signed, where you just split it up as the sum of two, as the difference of two positive bits, and prove the theorem to the two bits. So it's not going to be hard. So we won't write down the details. Okay. So this is really fancy here, the way this proof goes. So we let rho be mu plus mu, completely ridiculously. I have no idea who thought up this proof, perhaps Radon and Nicodem, but it's not something that I would have ever thought of. Okay, and we look at this Hilbert space, the L2 space with respect to rho. Okay, and so now, if I start with some vector psi in that L2 space, and I'm going to keep on writing up each measure because it matters here, and I send that to the integral of psi du. Okay, this is integrating it against some other measure. That's new there, not the measure that psi is actually defined with respect to. And let's call this map L. Okay, the point is this is a bounded linear functional. Well, so we just have to do this estimate. So L of psi, that's the right-hand side, absolute value of L of psi is, of course, greater than the integral of the absolute value of psi du. And then remember, nu, rho is mu plus nu, and nu is positive. So that's smaller than the integral of the absolute value of psi d rho, because rho is just a bigger measure. And now we're in the world where psi belongs, and we're integrating this vector rho, and so we can use Cauchy-Schwarz in that L2 space to see that this is the where we think of this as this function times the function 1. So it's the L2 norm of psi times the L2 norm of the function 1, which is just the square root of the volume of the whole space. That's the L2 norm of the function. Okay, and so here this is just some constant, and here's the norm of psi. So that was exactly us proving that L is a bounded linear function. Okay, so thus, now we use the Riesz representation theorem that we know what functionals look like. They're given by taking inner product with some vector. So there exists some fixed G in L2 of X rho, so that L of psi is equal to, and let's write out what L of psi is. That's the integral of psi d nu is equal to taking inner product over here, so that's the integral of g psi d rho. And you can see we're sort of, like, we're not there yet, but somehow we've done all the hard part, in the sense that we've just worked out how to convert an integral of some function with respect to nu into an integral with respect to rho, at the expense of picking up some extra function g. And that's kind of in the spirit of what's going on here, that you're meant to be able to change the sort of integral at the expense of some extra function, but of course it's not there yet, because this is still an integral d rho, and rho is the stupid thing we made up to start making some progress. Okay, but that's the formula that's going to make everything tick, so let's keep that there for a sec. Okay. So, we need to study this function g a little bit more. Let's plug in to that formula the characteristic function of some measurable z. And so what do we get? The left-hand side just says that the measure according to nu of that set E is the integral over E of g d rho. And then, of course, so that's bounded, though that's positive, nu is a positive measure, and nu of E is of course less than rho of E. Okay? So what did we just learn here? We will, for whatever the set E is, the integral of G on that set is at most the volume of that set. And that says, thus actually we have G between 0 and 1 almost everywhere. If you erase that, that was just there to help us derive the inequalities, and that's telling you that fact there. And we can just change G to make this true everywhere. Changing G on a set of measure 0 can't possibly change that property. Okay. So let A be the set where G is strictly less than 1, and B be the set where G is equal to 1. And now let's calculate a little bit. So the measure of nu is, of course, the integral of the characteristic function of the set B with respect to nu. And then we apply our magic formula that does everything for us. And that's now just the integral characteristic function of B times G d rho. But of course, on this set, when we're on B, G is equal to 1, we can just drop it. So that's just the integral over B d rho, which is nu of B plus mu of B. Ooh, that's nice. Okay. So mu of B is equal to 0. Okay. In fact, G is strictly less than equal to 1 almost everywhere. Okay. So another way of saying this, since mu is positive, this is actually just saying that mu is supported on A. Okay. Certainly, it's because mu is positive, it's 0 on any subset of B as well. Okay. And so that then finally lets us do the actual decomposition we want. The absolutely continuous piece is just going to be defined by taking nu on A, and the singular piece is just nu away from A. Okay. And nu s here is mutually singular. People sometimes write perpendicular like that. Nu s is perpendicular to nu. That was what we just checked there. Okay, so we still need to address the absolutely continuous, well, what we hope is the absolutely continuous part, and show that it really has the property we want. I still don't do this very often. I haven't done it yet, I think, on whiteboards, but when I'm working on pieces of paper now, every so often, my finger just goes up to the corner of the page to tap some button to change to eraser mode on my iPad, or like to go to the selection tool so I can grab something and slide it down to the corner of the board. It's very disconcerting. The paper doesn't do what you want. Okay, we have 1 minute to do this. Yikes. Okay. Okay, so, okay, let's just quickly rewrite this. Remember that there was the integral of g psi d mu plus nu, okay? So we can just rearrange this as the integral of psi 1 minus g mu equals the integral of psi g d mu. Okay, so, let's say this. So what happens if psi equals 1 over 1 minus g? Okay, let's just plug that in. We then, the left-hand side just becomes the measure of E, okay? And then the right-hand side becomes the integral of g over 1 minus g. Sorry, I think I screwed up somewhere there. Right. Okay, and that's fine. Because of course now if our set E had measure zero, this integral would be zero, so nu would have measure zero. So we would have shown that nu, I should be writing S here maybe. This is the official version of the formula. We're only thinking about the singular part now, so we should only do the integral. So we're only thinking about the absolute continuous part, so we should only be doing the integral over A. Okay. But this formula would tell us that it was absolutely continuous. The problem is, this might not be an L2. Okay? So I know we're out of time, but the point is you can just cheat. You can let psi sub n be this geometric series that would be converging to this guy, and I think I better stop. Is there a way to say it quickly? I think there's not a way to say it quickly, unfortunately, but you can do a little, these guys certainly are in L2, and using a little dominated convergence theorem argument, you can show that implies the right sort of absolute continuity for nu and mu, and you find, nevertheless, that this guy still is, that is actually in L2, and it is the Radon nicotine derivative. Okay. We better stop there. Sorry, maybe we can try and come back to the end of that argument next time, or maybe you can read the page and read the derivatives if you want to see how the end of that argument goes. We'll see. Okay, see you all on Friday.